morning. Happy Easter. Go ahead and stand. Let's worship together.
When he said it is finished, like my shame is gone. Won't be shackled to the way I was. I'm gonna live like my chains are gone. Gone. Now my sin is dead and gone. And I sing hallelujah.
Together. Father, we are so thankful that we can gather together today and we can celebrate that great reality that you were willing to send your Son and that he was willing to pay the price for our sins, that he was willing to endure the suffering and the shame and the death of the cross for our sakes, so that we could be brought back to you, so that we could worship you freely, so that our hearts could find their rest in you. And we are thankful that we celebrate today that Jesus did not remain dead, that the grave could not hold him, and that death no longer has dominion over him. And because we belong to him, death no longer has dominion over us. We are so thankful for all that you do for us, and we are so grateful that you are willing to give up your Son for all of us. We love you, we praise you, and we pray all these things in the name of your risen, living, and reigning Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Happy Easter, Horizons Church. Will you wander around and say hi to someone real quick?
Overcome. Mercy.
Isn't it great to actually be celebrating in person at church today as opposed to last year? Wow. I'm not depressed this Easter. It's amazing. I love it. If we haven't met yet, my name is Josiah. I'm the assistant campus pastor here at our Lost Creek campus. We're so glad that you are here worshiping with us today and celebrating the resurrection of Jesus with us, especially if you're new. If this is your first time, we are so glad that you are here, and we would love to meet you. So my father is going to be preaching the message today, and at the end of the service, he'll be over at our welcome area over there to your left where that sign just lit up. He'd love to put a gift in your hands and introduce himself and show you how you can get connected here at the church if you're new, all right? But if you're not maybe quite ready to take that step, but you do want to find out more about the church, we have another option for you. You can text us. So you just text the word Horizons to that number that's right there up on the screen, and you can ask us any questions you want or connect with us that way, and we can text you back through there. So if you're not quite ready to make it over to the welcome area, but you want to find out more, you can just text Horizons to that number up on the screen, and we'll get back to you by text, all right? And as always, if you haven't yet, we encourage you to download and utilize the Horizons Church app for all of your in-service needs. We've got sermon notes that you can follow along with the sermon. Got a connection card so you can update us on any information or changes in your life. And we also have a link for giving through the app. So we're only able to do the ministry that we do here because of your financial partnership and your generosity. So thank you so much to those of you who give. If this is your first time or you're new, you don't have to worry about this. We're not out for your money. But if you did come prepared to give, we are also in the middle of our Easter offering, so that's how we fund a number of projects that we do here at Lost Creek campus and all of our campuses. So if you did come prepared to give and you would like to contribute to the Easter offering, you can drop your gifts in the buckets as you're leaving or utilize any of the methods that are currently listed up on the screen right now. We do have a number of events coming up here at the church, so we got some video announcements about those. But over to my left and your right is our prayer room, and Lisa is in there praying for us. She'll be in there the whole service. So if you have a need and you would like to receive some prayer, please feel free to utilize that at any point. Lisa would be more than happy to pray with you, all right? We do have some video announcements, like I said, and then my father, Pastor Quint, will be up to deliver the Easter message, so take a look at the big screens.
It helped me.
It helped me.
It helped me.
And Grief Share can help you too. If you've lost someone you love and want to find healing in your grief, you can sign up today by going online to griefshare.org and search for a group near you.
Moms and dads, if your little ones find it difficult to remain quiet in today's worship service, please be courteous to those around you and take advantage of our cry rooms located in the back of the sanctuary. If the cry rooms are occupied, we have tables and sofas for family viewing in our cafe. Either way, you'll be able to see and hear everything, and your child will enjoy the extra freedom. And now, here's our lead pastor, Quint Pitts.
Ladies and gentlemen, the story you are about to see is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Dun da da, dun da 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 da, dun da da. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Yeah. All the young folks are saying, Dragnet? What's Dragnet? Anyway, do yourself a favor. If you've never seen a Dragnet TV show, you got to watch at least one. All right, this was a cops and robbers show from the 60s and 70s. Sergeant Joe Friday, just the facts, ma'am. And I'm not talking about the movie that Dan Aykroyd and Tom Hanks made in the 80s. I've never seen that, can't endorse it, but the TV show was awesome. And it always started off the same way every week. It started off by this guy saying, the names have been changed. The story you're about to see is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent. Well, I'm going to tell you right now a story that is true, but I have changed the names and I've changed some of the details to protect the innocent. And oh, by the way, I'm also protecting the guilty by changing these names, all right? So not terribly long ago, I was talking to a group of people and some guy walks up to me and starts just accusing me of all kinds of crazy things and calling me names, all right? You know how like when we were in grade school and junior high school, people just call you these immature names? Well, that's what this guy was doing, just calling me these really wild and immature names. And I was a little bit amused, a little bit annoyed, I had no recollection of ever meeting him. So I got a little closer trying to figure out, maybe if I get closer, I'll at least recognize who it is. But he was still a stranger to me. So I finally asked him, I said, who are you? You know, he wouldn't tell me his name, but he said he identified himself as Daisy's brother. All right. That's not a real name, but I'm changing the names to protect the guilty. All right. So Daisy's brother, who's a complete stranger to me, is calling me names and accusing me of awful things. I walked away from there somewhat amused, somewhat annoyed. I drove back home. The very next day, I'm opening emails. You know, and I open an email. It was one of those long ones, you know. Anytime you see a long email, it's probably not good, right? So I open this long email. And again, total stranger, didn't recognize the name. And this long email of this person, another person, not the same one from the day before, calling me awful names, you know, weird conspiracy theories, you know, just spewing them out there, accused me of everything except the Kennedy assassination. And I still don't know who this person is. And later on, I found out that we had met, that he and I had met, but we hadn't actually talked to each other for over 5 years. And oh, by the way, even after that, during that time we did know each other, we've probably exchanged 3 or 4 sentences the entire time we knew each other. But I found out this. I found out that this guy was married to Daisy's best friend. An hour after reading this email tirade, I got a call from somebody I actually did know, but I hadn't seen her or spoken to her for about 1.5 years. She said, hey, can we meet? I agreed, and we met. And when we did meet, she basically said, hey, I think you've been shady. You've been shady with the finances. I laughed out loud because I said, there's no way here at Horizons I could possibly be shady with the finances. There's so many checks and balances on our books. And oh, by the way, we get an outside audit every year from an outside auditing accounting firm. There's, even if I wanted to be shady with the finances, which I do not, but even if I wanted to be shady with the finances, there's no way I possibly could. No way. So I asked her, how did you get this crazy notion that I was shady with the finances? And she said, guess what? Guess what she said? Daisy told me. So I sat there, and in 24 hours time, this person, Daisy, who was a friend of mine, I trusted implicitly for 20 years. Have you ever been betrayed? Have you ever been betrayed? I bet you every person in this room over the age of 10 could probably tell me a story similar to what I just told you, right? Different details, but it would be very similar, wouldn't it? And here's the deal. It's a universal thing, isn't it? We hate betrayers. We despise betrayers. We loathe betrayers. You know, if human literature and movies and all that stuff is kind of an indicator, we really don't like betrayers at all. You remember how Dante described the ninth circle of hell, where the worst of the worst were kept in torment for all eternity? The ninth circle of hell was reserved for treachery, right? Betrayers and traitors were there in this frozen lake, captured in the frozen lake. Well, if movies and literature are an indicator, we don't like betrayers. We don't like them at all. And I wonder why. I wonder why we despise betrayers so much. Anybody got an idea on why? Here's my theory. First of all, it is universal, right? We've all experienced it. It's one of the worst experiences that we all share as human beings. So that might be one reason that we despise betrayers. Another reason is this. What does it do to your soul when you get betrayed? You know, as I was sitting there in my office and the depth of Daisy's betrayal started to sink in, guess what was going through my mind? And it wasn't revenge. I mean, that comes later, right? You just want to kill them, right? But that wasn't the first thing that goes through your mind when you get betrayed like this. You know what the first thing that went through my mind was? What a fool I've been, right? What an absolute idiot that I've done. I've trusted this person implicitly for 20 years. And you know, betrayal is one of those sins that makes the victim of the sin feel like you're an idiot for allowing yourself to be victimized, right? You're the bad guy for letting this person betray you. It's really sad and it's really ridiculous, but that's the way we feel about it. So here's the deal. I think another reason, this is probably the most insidious part of betrayal, and I think this is probably the reason we hate it so much, is this. When you get betrayed, it fills your whole worldview for a while, doesn't it? You see everything else through that betrayal. It is the lens through which you look at every other relationship. So it doesn't just destroy one relationship. Betrayal diminishes all my other relationships. Because I start thinking to myself, if I can't trust Daisy, I can't trust George, I can't trust Jim, and all of my relationships get diminished a little bit every time that I am betrayed. We hate betrayers. We despise betrayers. We loathe them. All I have to do is mention their names, right? And it makes our skin crawl a little, doesn't it? I mean, Benedict Arnold. Now, they don't teach history anymore, but Benedict Arnold is the all-time greatest traitor in all of American history. So you old, young folks will have to ask somebody, you know. But he is synonymous with betrayal, isn't he? We don't even think of a man anymore when we hear the name Benedict Arnold. We just think of betrayal. Marcus Brutus, you know, Julius Caesar, he's being assassinated, he's being murdered by the Roman senators, and it's the Ides of March, and his best friend, Brutus, Marcus Brutus, walks up and plunges in the final knife, and Shakespeare puts into his mouth those famous words, "You too, Brutus, you too," as he lays there and all of his lifeblood is bleeding out of him. Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, they betrayed us to the Soviets during the Cold War. Tokyo Rose, she betrayed us to the Japanese during the World War II. So that lineup right there on the screen, if there was an all-star team for betrayers, that would be it right there. There's your all-star team. But every team has to have a captain, right? So the all-star team of betrayers has a captain, and this is this guy right here. Rich Rod! That dude. Yeah. There's the most dastardly doer of deeds we have ever seen. Betrayed every man, woman, and child in the state of West Virginia. His life's gone well since then, isn't it? I think he's the offensive coordinator for Rocco Bulo School of Women right now. I think that's where he is. Yeah, we will never forget that. We are never going to forget that. That was 14 years ago, guys. 14 years. We remember it, buddy. We remember it. But in all seriousness, the granddaddy of all betrayers is who? Judas Iscariot, right? Judas Iscariot, he is the ultimate human villain, isn't he? He's the guy that we think of. Now, the man who betrayed Jesus, he's the worst example of human villainy. He's so despised, we don't even think of him as a human being anymore, do we? When we think Judas Iscariot, we think of a cartoon caricature of evil. You know, like Dick Dastardly, you know, from those old cartoons, or Snidely Whiplash, you know, from the old Dudley Do-Right cartoons. We don't even think of Judas as a human. He's just this sneaky, slimy, sinister scumbag, you know, rolling around Jesus, waiting for an opportunity to sell him out. But you know, the real picture of Judas was quite different than that. That wasn't the image that Jesus had of Judas. That wasn't the image that the other disciples had of Judas. I mean, think about it for a minute. Of all the people on planet Earth, Jesus chose Judas to be in his inner circle of top 12 followers. And the other disciples, they must have trusted Judas a little bit because they let him carry the group's money around. They let him carry the group's money and pay the group's bills. So he must have had a level of trust. You know, the thing that's most disturbing to me about Judas is he reminds me of me. Don't look at me like that because he reminds me of you too. Right? Judas was a very committed follower of Jesus. He left everything. He left his profession. He left his family and he traveled with Jesus for 3 years. He's a very committed follower of Jesus. I'm a very committed follower of Jesus. Judas got frustrated when Jesus didn't do what he wanted him to do. I get frustrated with Jesus when he doesn't answer my prayers the way I think he should answer my prayers. Eventually, the frustration of Judas led up to him being completely fed up, and he betrayed Jesus. And guys, I've been there. I got fed up. I remember walking around in a funk one day saying these things to God. I don't even know why I pray anymore. You never answer them the way I want you to. You know, wah, 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 whine, whine, whine. Completely fed up. That's happened to me. It's probably happened to you maybe once or twice. Because here's the thing. Judas didn't betray Jesus because he's just this evil guy. He betrayed Jesus because of some frustration and being fed up. It's a rather common issue among those of us who betray Jesus. In fact, let's look at the scene where it kind of tipped over, all right? This is Mark chapter 14. And this is the scene that pushes Judas over the edge, okay? He's been circling the drain for quite a while, but this is the scene where it's kind of over for Judas. His frustration level gets to a high level in Mark 14. All right, let's start reading at verse 3. While Jesus was in Bethany, Bethany's just a few miles outside of the capital city of Jerusalem. This is right before what we call the triumphant entry. It's right before what we call Palm Sunday, okay? Right in that area. It's right before the last week of Jesus on earth. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table, a man named Simon the leper, a woman came. And there's another gospel writer who gives us the additional detail that this woman's name is Mary. She's Mary of Bethany. That's Martha's sister. That's Lazarus' sister. A woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on Jesus' head. Some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, "Why this waste?" Another guy's gospel writer gives us the detail that the guy who's really complaining the most vocally about it is Judas. Judas is the one who's expressing his disgust. Why this waste of perfume? It could have been said, it could have been sold for more than a year's wages and the money given to the poor. And they rebuked Mary harshly. Look how Jesus responds. "Leave her alone," said Jesus. "Why are you bothering her? She's done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you'll always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want, but you will not always have me. She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare me for my burial." To prepare me for my burial? That's kind of an odd thing to say, isn't it? Kind of a weird thing to say. But this is the story. Judas doesn't approve of any of this. Judas doesn't approve of anything Mary's doing. Judas doesn't approve of this extravagant display of worship that Mary is pouring out on Jesus. Judas doesn't approve of Jesus just sitting there and letting her give him this extravagant worship. Judas doesn't approve of the waste of money involved in this. And this is the tipping point. This is where his frustration goes to, "I'm fed up." Judas doesn't approve, even after 3 years of being with Jesus, even after 3 years of long walks with Jesus and long talks with Jesus, even after 3 years of hearing everything that he uttered, every syllable of his teaching, even after 3 years of watching Jesus perform miracle after miracle after miracle, Judas still doesn't get Jesus. He still doesn't understand him. He still doesn't understand Jesus' priorities. He still doesn't understand Jesus' primary mission. And what he does understand, what he does understand about Jesus' priorities and mission, he don't like much. Basically, he and I are in the same place a lot of times, and probably you too. We get frustrated when we misunderstand Jesus' priorities and his primary mission. We get frustrated. And man, if there was ever a generation of Christians in America that doesn't understand Jesus' priorities and primary mission, it's us. We just don't get it. We don't understand what he's all about. You see, Jesus failed to meet Judas' expectations. Judas began to question whether it was even worth it to follow Jesus at this point. Here's what J.D. Greer says. Judas believed that the primary mission of Jesus was to make his life better. and to wrong those, or to punish those who wronged him. Folks, that's a whole boatload of American Christians today. Jesus is just out there to improve my life. Jesus is just out there to make my life better. Is there something in your life where you expect Jesus to take care of it, but he's not giving it enough attention? Is there some entitlement? Is there some blessing that you feel entitled to in this life, and he's not really meeting that entitlement? Man, we get frustrated when that happens, don't we? What sort of blessings did you expect? What kind of expectations did you come into your relationship with Jesus with? I've made fun of myself enough here, but I want to do it one more time, okay? One more time. My crazy expectations, I first became a Christian. I was a high school student, didn't know anything about God, didn't know anything about Jesus, but I knew enough that I wanted to become a Christian. And my expectation, I know this sounds crazy, but my expectation was, as a young 15-year-old boy, was now that I got Jesus on my side, my life's going to get better. In fact, I'm going to start hitting 500 in baseball every year. I'm going to start making 12 tackles a game in football every year. I'm going to start making straight A's, and I'm going to get myself a pretty girlfriend. I really felt that way. I did. I know it sounds crazy, but those were my expectations. I've got God on my side now. In essence, Judas is following Jesus because he expects him to get rid of the Romans. Judas fully expects Jesus to kick the Roman occupation army out of Israel. Judas fully expects Jesus to set up a political kingdom. In fact, he's not the only disciple who thinks that. All of them probably think that. They're all arguing about it. Just a few days before this event, they're all arguing about, hey, who's going to be the so-and-so and the what and the big important guy in the new kingdom? And when Judas hears Jesus talking about his death and he hears Jesus, this thing with she's preparing me for my burial, that just pushed Judas over the edge. He realizes there's no way I'm going to get what I want out of this. I'm just not going to get it. And he decides to do the awful thing that he decided to do. Look at verse 10. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priests to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted to hear this, and they promised to give Judas money. Another gospel writer tells us that Judas asked them how much. So he watched for an opportunity to hand him over. Jesus was just a means to an end for Judas. And when he realized he wasn't going to get the end, he didn't need Jesus anymore. So he betrayed him. And many of you know the rest of the story. You know that about a week later, Judas shows up with some Roman, or with some soldiers. They were temple soldiers, I think, rather than Roman soldiers. But he shows up with some soldiers in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he betrays Jesus with a kiss, which is a pretty ironic way to betray a man, I think. But that's how he did it. Judas' story does not end well. In fact, it ends very badly. Here's how Matthew describes Judas' ending. When Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse. He returned the 30 silver coins to the chief priests and the elders and said, I have sinned, I betrayed innocent blood. Well, what is that to us? They replied, that's your responsibility. So Judas threw the money into the temple and left, and then he went away and he hanged himself. He went away and he hanged himself. Folks, Judas' story didn't have to end this way, but it did. You say, Pitts, how do you know Judas' story didn't have to end this way? Because there was another betrayer there that night. And his story didn't end that way. You see, Judas the betrayer isn't the only betrayer that betrayed Jesus this awful night. Anybody remember a guy named Simon Peter? Simon Peter didn't just betray Jesus once. He didn't just betray Jesus twice. He betrayed Jesus three times. And Simon Peter was the guy who was bragging about how strong his love for Jesus was. And he said, my love for Jesus is stronger than all these other clowns combined. Look at how he says it in verse 29. Peter declared, even if all fall away, I will not. Even if I have to die with you, Jesus, I will never disown you. Bold words, but Peter did exactly that. He betrayed Jesus just as certainly as Judas betrayed Jesus, and he did it three times. Three times he denied that he even knew who Jesus was. You see, folks, we don't just get frustrated we also get fearful, right? We get fearful when we realize that Jesus might actually ask us to follow him into difficult and dangerous places. You see, nobody bargains for that, do we? We usually don't bargain, especially those of us in America. We just don't bargain for it. Jesus asking us to do something difficult? Jesus asking us to follow him into a place that's dangerous? Surely Jesus wouldn't ask us to do that. Because Jesus' primary mission is to do what? Make my life better. So since he's all about making my life better, he ain't going to ask me to do anything dangerous. Do you know how many Christians were martyred last year? Christians killed for the only reason that they served and worshiped Jesus. Do you know how many Christians have been killed just this year? Killed for the only reason that they love and worship Jesus. Jesus asked those people to serve him and worship him in a very dangerous place, and it cost them their lives. We don't bargain for that. We don't bargain for that at all. Peter broke his oaths to Jesus, these strong oaths. I'll never disown you. I'll die for you. And all of that stuff melted away as soon as Peter confronted danger. The danger in the streets of Jerusalem were palpable that night, and he caved. All of those things melted away in order for Peter to experience self-preservation. You see, self-preservation is the strongest instincts that you human beings share together, right? It is the number one instinct we have is self-preservation. It's the strongest grip on our hearts. So only the highest forms of love, only the deepest commitments of love will ever allow us to push past our instinct for self-preservation in order to do the right thing for the person that we love. There is very few people that can get that kind of love. In fact, that's what Jesus said one day, didn't he? He said, greater love has no man than to lay down his life for his friend. See, Jesus knows what that's like because he did exactly that. Jesus pushed past his instinct for self-preservation, and he allowed himself to be sacrificed as an offering for our sins to take away our guilt. Jesus knows what's that like. Peter couldn't muster that kind of love for Jesus that night. At least not that night, he couldn't. Many of you know the story. These betrayals led to the kangaroo court, the mock trial. Jesus was beaten to a pulp by the Roman soldiers. He was forced to carry his cross through the narrow streets of Jerusalem to a place called Golgotha. He was nailed to that cross. He was tortured and tormented to death for 6 hours, and he finally died. He died. And they put him in a borrowed tomb. They buried him in a borrowed tomb. And today, Christians all around the world, in every nook and cranny of this globe, Christians, billions of them, are celebrating the fact that Jesus died, but he didn't stay dead. He didn't stay dead. You can't keep a good man down. And Jesus came out of that grave, resurrected that first Easter morning. Judas' story ended badly. Guess what? Peter's story could have ended pretty badly too. The Bible says that after Peter betrayed Jesus those 3 times, he went out and wept bitterly. The same cocktail of emotions, the same cocktail of feelings that Judas had experienced were the same things that Peter is experiencing. Judas' experience led him to wreckage, ruin, and death. Peter didn't. Why not? Why not? Why is Judas the betrayer known as the most evil human being, the worst villain ever? And why did Peter go down in history as one of the most loved church leaders of all time? Why is Peter given the privilege of writing part of the New Testament? Why is Peter's impact on the church still being felt today, 2,000 years after his death? Why? What's the difference? Here's the difference. Betrayal never has to be final. You see, betrayal never has to be final. It doesn't have to be the final chapter of your life. It doesn't have to be the final sentence written about you. See, here's an issue. We hate betrayers. We despise betrayers. We loathe betrayers, but we are betrayers. We are betrayers. We receive it. It's universal. We receive betrayal. But it's also equally universal that we dish it out. We betray our friends. We betray our coworkers. We betray our family members. We betray teammates and classmates. We betray God. We betray Jesus. And left to our own devices, folks, we'll end up just like Judas. We'll end up in wreckage and ruin and despair and death. But thank God we don't have to follow that example. We can take a different path. We can go to the path of Jesus. We can go to the path of Peter took. So let's drop in on the scene where Peter's trajectory changed, right? That's John chapter 21, if you got your Bible. John chapter 21. This is where Peter's trajectory changed. He's circling the same drain that Judas circled. But this is where it all changes. All right, let me set the scene for you. This is a week or two. We don't know exactly how long it's been, but it's been a week or two since Jesus came out of that grave, okay? Several of the disciples went back to their hometowns around the Sea of Galilee, and they go back to fishing. That was their trade, so they started fishing. And this is the scene where we show up. Basically, they are in the same location that Jesus found them 3 years earlier, and they're doing exactly the same thing that Jesus found them doing 3 years earlier, okay? Verse 4 of John 21. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize it was Jesus. Now, folks, this is kind of comical. They can't see him because it's still early light. They can't see him because they're about 150 yards offshore in a boat. But I want you to notice how Jesus appears here. He's so nonchalant about it, isn't he? He's just, you know, strolling down the beach. If I was the Messiah of the world and I had just conquered death, I might try something like this. Behold the resurrected Christ. I think I might have tried that. Jesus is nonchalantly walking down the beach, right? They don't recognize who he is. They don't recognize his voice. So he calls out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? And every fisherman loves that question. No, they answered. He said, throw your net on the right side of the boat. You'll find some. When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Jesus just recreated the miracle when he met these guys 3 years earlier. He's in the same place. They're doing the same thing with the same results. And he does the same miracle. John Eldridge calls this the ultimate insider joke. This is the ultimate inside joke. This is Jesus being playful with his friends. They don't recognize him. He's nonchalant walking down the beach, and he does the same thing he did for them 3 years earlier when they met. And this is, and when they didn't recognize the man, but they recognized the miracle. They said, oh, that's got to be Jesus. And they start pulling for shore, rowing to shore. Peter's so excited, he jumps out of the boat. He was fishing naked, they said. You know, he had to put clothes on. I don't know why you put clothes on to jump into the water, but he did. That shows you how confused that man was. He's pretty confused. They rush back to shore. When they arrive, Jesus has already started a fire for them. He's already got fish. I don't know where he caught them. You know, he's already caught fish, and they're being grilled on the barbie. You know, he's already got bread being grilled there. And I want you to notice how this goes. I mean, Jesus invites Peter the betrayer to sit down with him. Jesus says to Peter the betrayer, hey, if you want me to, I'll grill some of your fish. And he says to Peter the betrayer, let's have breakfast together. There's something missing from this scene, folks. You notice how welcoming it is? You know how peaceful it is? The little inside joke, the playfulness. What's missing? There's something missing from this scene. It should be there, but it isn't there. How about a little resentment? How about a little, Peter, how could you? I needed you that night. You had promised me that you would die for me if need be. And I heard you say you didn't even know who I was. There's not a hint of resentment. There's not a whisper of condemnation. That's a pretty important part of the story. Now, Jesus isn't silly. He's not going to ignore the betrayal. He's not going to pretend it didn't happen. I know American Christians, we think that, don't we? We think our sin doesn't matter. We can just break every rule that God has, and he'll just be a doddering old grandfather patting us on the head. You're a good boy. You're a good boy. No. God always takes sin seriously. Jesus took this betrayal seriously. But I want you to see how he handles it, all right? Look at how he treats Peter the betrayer, all right? When they had finished eating, so some time has passed, in other words. They've had time to sit there and count fish. We know they counted them up. They said there's 153 fish here. I don't know how long it takes to count 153 wiggling fish, but probably a while. They had barbecued enough fish to feed seven men. They had grilled enough bread to feed seven men. They had eaten. They had told stories. And now Jesus turns his attention to Simon Peter. He singles him out in front of the group. Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these?" Man, Peter was hoping he didn't ask that. Peter is hoping, like you and I hope, that God will just look over our sin and kind of pretend it didn't happen. "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs. Feed my lambs." So what is Jesus doing for Peter here? Jesus is offering Peter the betrayer a chance to receive forgiveness. Jesus is offering Peter the betrayer a chance to recommit his life to Jesus. And Jesus is offering Peter the betrayer something his soul desperately craves right now, validation. I haven't changed my mind about you, Peter. I haven't changed my mind about you. I still want you to shepherd my church. That's that whole feed my lambs thing. That's all. That's Jesus saying to Peter, "I haven't changed my mind about you. I know you've betrayed me, but I haven't changed my mind about you. I still want you to lead my church. I still want you to shepherd my church." Look at verse 16. Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was hurt. That's the understatement of the Bible right there. Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." And then he said to him, "Follow me." In response to Peter's three betrayals that awful night, Jesus gives him three opportunities to receive forgiveness. Jesus gives Peter the betrayal three opportunities to recommit his life to him. He gives him three opportunities to hear that affirmation, "I still love you. I still want you to be a part of my church. I still want you to lead my people. I validate you, Peter. I validate you." One for each betrayal. This is a beautiful story. And it shows, guys, it shows us in vivid, living color how Jesus treats us, betrayers. You see, the resurrected Jesus loves to offer forgiveness to those of us who betray him. And that's all of us. We've all betrayed Jesus. And he loves to offer forgiveness. I know that when we sin and we turn our backs on God, I know we think he's just begrudgingly doing it. He loves us because he has to love us, but he doesn't like us very much. That is not the scene here. That is not at all the scene here. I know you're sick of hearing, but I'm going to point it out one more time. There's no resentment. There's no condemnation. We've looked at two men who betrayed their friend Jesus. One man, Judas, ended up in wreckage, ruin, and death and despair. Peter's story ended very differently. He went down as a hero in the church. He went down as a great influencer in the church. He's still influencing us today. And there's only one difference. There's only one difference between those two men. Judas refused to receive forgiveness from Jesus. He refused to humble himself and go back to Jesus. He refused to run to Jesus when he had wronged him. When Peter wronged Jesus, what did he do? He ran to him. He ran to him. He jumped out of the boat naked, trying to pull clothes on. Ran to him. And Peter humbled himself and received that forgiveness that he needed. Peter humbled himself and recommitted his life to Christ three times on that beach. I want you to notice the capacity that Jesus has to forgive us. It never runs out. It never runs out. The whole point of this Easter story is that we have a God who's willing to die for us. And we have a Savior who loves, loves, loves to forgive us. I love how J.D. Greer puts it. We are far more like Judas than we could have imagined. At the same time, we are far more loved by Jesus than we could ever dream. Despite our sin, betrayal, misunderstandings, and false expectations, Jesus loves us and offers us forgiveness. Folks, we are a lot like Judas, but we don't have to share his fate. We can take a different route. I'm going to give you a chance to make that choice today, okay? Now, if you don't go to church every week and you may not be familiar with things, this part of the church is kind of front part. We call this the altar. And this is where we do some of our most serious business with God. This is where we do some of our most serious praying to God. So I'm going to invite you to come. I'm going to invite you to come and receive the forgiveness that Jesus offers to all of us, betrayers. I'm going to invite you to come and recommit your life to Christ. Maybe there was a time when you did have a relationship with God, but it's gone now and you want to recommit. I'm going to give you a chance to do that. And I'm going to do that. I'm going to kneel down right here. I've got some things that are going on in my soul that I need to talk to God about. Now, look, I promise you, we're not going to bother you, all right? You come up here and pray, we're going to let you talk to Jesus. There are times to talk to counselors, but this isn't one of them, all right? Notice Peter isn't talking to a counselor. He's talking directly to Jesus, isn't he? Now, if you want to have somebody pray with you, that's what the prayer room's all about, and there's somebody in there, they'll be happy to pray with you if you want to. But I'm just going to invite you, those of you who want to, just come on down here and just kneel down here at the altar and talk to Jesus about this. Tell him. Lord, I've sinned, I've really failed you, I've betrayed you, and I need your forgiveness, and I want to recommit my life. I want to give my life to you, all right? We're all going to be worshiping. The rest of you guys, we're going to ask you to worship. You know your worship will help create an environment for the Holy Spirit to work in people's lives. So if you're not coming down to kneel, then I'll ask you to stand with us. Let's all worship together.
The head that once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior now to wash our feet, now at His feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love, now shines for all to see. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. And all praise will rise to Christ our King. That held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive in me. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. And all praise will rise to Christ our King. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected
surrounding me that pray at your name still, call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every way at your name, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Silence fear, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Call these bones to live, call these lungs to sing once again. Jesus, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. If that don't bless you, your blesser is broke. I love you guys. Have a great week. If you're new, I'd love to meet you right over here. Go home and watch some Dragnet. It'll be awesome.